Research from the Minneapolis Federal Reserve Bank shows that early childhood education has substantial and positive impacts on individual well-being and economic success. But when it comes to government-sponsored preschool education that meets a twice-a-week threshold, only about 1 in 7 of Minnesota's 4-year-olds are enrolled, compared to more than 1 in 3 of the 4-year-olds nationwide. Should Minnesota work to increase the quality, affordability, and accessibility of preschool education opportunities, and if so, how?
Well, absolutely. As I said in my opening remarks, I think one of the hallmarks of redesign is putting money where we know we're going to get a return, putting money where there's a good investment, setting priorities. And in my mind, against a $6 billion shortfall, there can be no more important investment Minnesota makes than investing in early childhood education. I think it's where our first dollar ought to go. We've seen the data from Art Rolnick and others on the 17-to-1 return, and I think that's a compelling argument. But I also think as we look at the growth of early childhood education, we have to do a couple of things wisely. One is that we need to make sure that the programs we're investing in are the best programs. We've seen on a number of occasions where, as an issue gains traction, a lot of potential providers come in. We need to make sure that every dollar is going to the best purpose possible. And secondly, we need to be creative. I've been part of an organization, Serve Minnesota, that has created the Minnesota Reading Corps that leverages state and federal dollars, uses trained volunteers as mentors, and drives education forward.
Thank you. I'll repeat the question again. Research from the Minnesota Federal Reserve Bank shows that early childhood education has substantial and positive impacts on individual well-being and economic success. But when it comes to government-sponsored preschool education that meets a twice-a-week threshold, only about 1 in 7 of Minnesota's 4-year-olds are enrolled, compared to more than 1 in 3 of the 4-year-olds nationwide. Should Minnesota work to increase the quality, affordability, and accessibility of preschool education opportunities, and if so, how?
Yes, it should, and again, it's about the dollars. You know, I volunteered in a Head Start program when I was in college over 40 years ago, and it was well understood, documented back then, that Head Start made an incredible difference in the readiness of those children, and yet today there's a sufficient funding nationwide for less than half of all the children that are Head Start eligible to attend. So it is about resources. It needs to be the public sector. It needs to be the private sector, the faith community, nonprofits. We do need to look for those that are most successful, and I think it's very encouraging that Dwayne Benson, working in conjunction with some of the businesses in the area, as well as Todd Otis and others, so we have a bipartisan recognition of the value of this. And it is about everything from prenatal care to very early childhood experiences to pre-kindergarten, the fact that we're one of the few states that has not provided state funding for all-day kindergarten. It's about taking children from literally conception all the way through and into lifelong learning. And we have to recognize that our educational system all the way through is going to be the key to our future prosperity and success.
Thank you. Rob Hahn, research from the Minnesota Federal Reserve Bank shows that early childhood education has substantial and positive impacts on individual well-being and economic success. But when it comes to government-sponsored preschool education that meets a twice-a-week threshold, only about 1 in 7 Minnesota's 4-year-olds are enrolled, compared to more than 1 in 3 of the 4-year-olds nationwide. Should Minnesota work to increase the quality, affordability, and accessibility of preschool education opportunities, and if so, how?
The simple answer is yes, absolutely. The more complicated answer, and I want to echo what both Mark and Tom said, is that we need to look at where we're spending it now and do an analysis of what's working. Identify those programs that are successful, look at how they're being funded, and try to create more like them. Conversely, I think we have to look at some of those, frankly, that might not be working right, that may be getting government funds but just aren't producing the results. We need to be results driven, even with pre-K through 12 education, because if we're not results driven and people aren't held accountable, then we're going to run into just a money pit where more money is being thrown. And not everything needs to be government funded in these situations. I like the idea that Mark suggested about being creative, working with private partnerships, working with churches and other faith-based outlets to find ways to utilize talents of individuals and make sure that we're investing not just money, but time and people into these types of education.
Thank you, and I'm going to switch it up a little bit. I'm not going to repeat the question every time unless the candidate wants me to, because it's getting a little, so if you'd like me to repeat it, I will, but otherwise I'll do it once and...
We could repeat the question.
Yeah, yes, but if anyone does need me to, please ask me to, but I'll just do it at the beginning.
I'm just impressed with a 10-month-old you can remember the order that you're in and things like that, so... I first want to recognize former Mayor Don Frazier, who's back over here, who has been one of our leading lights on early childhood education. When I was leader of the Democrats in our state house, they asked me to sit down with him and George Latimer and a number of other folks who were working on early childhood issues. And we've had a great group that's come together in this community. But you notice over the last couple of legislative sessions, at the same time there's been a lot of discussion, not much has happened. And that's where it gets to the priority issue and the question. We've had a governor who has believed the way forward is slashing. And when you cut, you don't move forward, you move backwards. So my priorities are going to have to be this. With a $6 billion plus dollar deficit, you have to solve that first. You can't promise to spend money on these things unless you solve the deficit, and I've laid out a plan to do that. Then as we get the economy going, and I believe the clean energy economy is a quick way to get the economy going and get new jobs going, you have to decide where to invest, and I believe early childhood along with K-12 and higher ed are the first places we need to invest in the state.